Well, good morning, church. We are so glad y'all are here. Why don't you stand with us as we sing? Thank you. my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed.
Now my head.
Me straight, you're the heaven where we are.
Amen. Y'all can be seated. Amen.
I'll get baptized because I ask him into my heart and he's my savior. I'm Jonas and I'm going to get baptized.
Jonas, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal savior? Yes. All right. Upon your public profession of faith, I baptize you, my son, in the name of the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection.
I'll get baptized because I ask him into my heart and he's my savior. I'm Jonas and I'm going to get baptized.
Jonas, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal savior? Yes. All right. Upon your public profession of faith, I baptize you, my son, in the name of the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised in the likeness of his resurrection.
Well, good morning. I'm Irish, so happy St. Patrick's Day. Just met a couple that was married on this day. Congratulations back there. They're like, don't call us out. Would y'all like to stand? No, I'm teasing. Don't stand up. So I told first hour I'm going to cry a lot today. If you're uncomfortable with a grown man crying, now's your time to get out. However, it's always easier saying it things the second time. Paul will be back next week, our lead pastor. The reason is because today's a big day for us, for me. Paul announced a few weeks ago that after 30 years and a few months, we would be leaving Family Fellowship and we'd be moving to Northwest Arkansas. Not quite sure what the next chapter holds for us yet. We're going to focus on some health and some things like that. But, you know, as I begin to think about what the next chapter of life looked like for us, it was not easy. Matter of fact, it was really difficult because the thing that dawned on me very quickly was that, you know, 98% of the people that I love most are in this auditorium today. And those have been relationships that have been born out over a long time and a lot of investment on both my and your parts. But the thing that was even more difficult than that was that 99% of the people that love me most we're in this building today. And you don't just drive away from that without really thinking about that. And that was one of the things Paul asked me when we sat down to have this very difficult conversation about what was next for us. And this church is amazing, and it's been wonderful. And we have loved and poured our life into it, and we will greatly miss each and every one of you. And now's the time to go if you don't like tears, okay? I'm going to miss this church. One of the other things I'm going to miss is I have, part of my responsibilities here have been to missions. So I've taken 63 missions trips, I think, for this church. Hundreds of people on missions trips. And one of the things that people always say when we get on these trips, we go very, very, I'll use the word organic. We just really like to travel and get out amongst whatever country we're in. And one of the things people always are struck with is, you know, and they always say this, is just how blessed they are to realize that we're, how blessed we are to be born in America, right? The very fact that we can be here today reminds us, just the fact that we can meet without threat and worship Jesus this morning, right? That's amazing, and that's incredible, and there is an increasingly hostile world towards that, even in our own country, but thank God not here. But you don't really need to leave the country to realize how blessed we are. You could walk out into our parking lot and walk around our parking lot and see, hey, we're pretty blessed, right? You don't even really have to go out into our parking lot, though. I like to say this. If you really want to know how blessed we are in America, all you need to do is take a tour of the churches lost and found. Folks, if I could take you back into the churches lost and found right now, you'd say, oh my gosh, there's $11,000 worth of Yetis in here, all right? I mean, I have added to my Yeti collection and my Stanley. Y'all are fighting for Stanleys. I got 14 at home. They're y'all's, but I got them now, right? I've got hunting jackets. And I'm not like a buzzer just kind of hovering around it. But if it's in there about a week or two, I figure it's fair game. No, I'll usually wait a couple of months. Here recently, I added a new edition from the church, Lost and Found, to my collection. It's on the screen behind me. Man, that thing worked great. Now, there's a good chance somebody out there right now is saying, hey, that's mine. That's where I left it. If that's yours, come to me. I'll clean it for you. I only used it 1 week. Or if you can prove it, I will buy you a replacement. But that thing worked really well. So, I'm going to miss Greenville. I'm going to, I've been waiting for, I didn't say this first service. I got a little more time, I know. I've been waiting for 30 years for a steakhouse. Really? So, it is what it is, I guess. So, as I began to think about this, probably with all intents and purposes, being the last time that I would speak here in front of the church that has loved me and that I've loved so dearly, loved us, I am a sports fanatic, not as much as I used to be, but I began to kind of try to contextualize it in that way. So I have watched hundreds probably of sports retirement, athlete retirement ceremonies through the years. Whether they're hanging up their skates or putting the bat away or the glove or the pads or whatever it is, most athletes, they'll step away for a month or two, kind of talk to the people that they're closest to, and then they'll call a press conference with the logo of the team they're retiring from behind them and the people that mean most to them on either side. And they really like to believe that their press conference, this retirement press conference, is bigger than just their stats. So they'll almost always have a theme if you think about it. Go watch them. Go just YouTube someday. They'll almost always want it to be something more about more than just bigger than just how many home runs they hit. So they'll say things like, I've wanted my career to point to cancer because I lost my mom when she was young, or I rose from poverty and no one in my family had ever not only gone to college, they had never even graduated high school, and so I've really wanted my career to invest in literacy and to help underprivileged, kids rise up out of their situation. Or they'll say they wanted their career to represent that they brought their lunch pail to work every single day, right? That they were known as a hard worker. If anything else, they didn't have the talent and the abilities of others, but they were a hard worker. And I really began to then just focus that. But I have been a hard worker. But not that. I've wanted to focus then on, then what if I'm only going to be here one more time on this spot, what would I want to leave with you? And that's where I came up with, I think the Lord gave it to me, all things. All things. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Now, before I go any further, let's talk a little bit. I'll get to the all things in just a second, but let's talk about the those who love him, and let's understand what the scripture's really talking about there. Those who love him, really what Paul is saying there is those who've accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Those who have the Holy Spirit inhabiting them and drawing their heart, their affections towards God. Now, we are in our 100th anniversary celebration year. As a matter of fact, the last Sunday in April, April 28th, we will celebrate our 100th anniversary. But what has made this church great for 100 years is not the nice seats we have or the free coffee or the donuts or even the wonderful people that come here. What has made this church great is our commitment to the gospel, presenting the good news around the world and in Texas and the United States. And what we want you to understand this morning is first and foremost this, that if you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, today you can. And it's not about how bad you've been or how good you've been. And it's not about the things that you've done that you don't think he could save you from or the things that you haven't done that you feel like you should have. And it's not about how many diplomas you have on the wall or how successful you are at your job or whatever. It has never been about it. I've done a lot of funerals, a lot in my time here. And I know it's cliched, but people always leave here the same way. And what matters when you take that last breath is, do you know Jesus as your Savior? Have you given your life to Him? And understand that He gave His life for you. It's never been about us. It has always been about God's love for us and His Son dying on the cross. And once we understand that and give our life to Him, ask Him to forgive us of our sins and accept Him as our Savior, then we can begin to understand what we're going to talk about today. All things have a purpose. So I need to go back 30 years. We came here without really a plan, kind of like we're leaving here, I guess. And didn't really know what God was doing. My wife's parents were here, so we came here. They had not been in this facility that long. My mother-in-law was the church secretary here. A preacher, Paul's dad, was the pastor then. He asked my mother-in-law to, we were staying with him for 3 or 4 weeks while we tried to figure things out. He asked her to have me come talk to him. So I came up here. I think it was a Monday, actually. I came up here on that Monday, met with preacher, and he said, hey, you know, what do you got? What's going on next? I said, I have no idea. He says, well, I think you want to come work here. And I said, well, I don't really think so, you know. And he said, well, no, I really think you ought to come here. And I said, well, I kind of think I might want to go to Austin. He's like, you don't want to go to Austin. And I'm like, yeah, I kind of do, you know. Sorry for you A&M people. Love you too. Jesus loves everybody, right? And he said, no, I think you really want to come here. But he said, I'll tell you what. I said, well, preacher, let me go home and talk to Deidre and we'll pray about it. He said, well, I'll give you till tomorrow, which is so preacher. That's his perfect response. And, of course, I went home and said, hey, preacher wants us to come work here. And you know what the answer was, right? Yes. So I came back up here the next day, and quickly we just, you know, started working. And pretty soon after coming on staff, I became one of the youth staff. And we had been married about 5 years at the time and decided that that was probably, now that we felt like we were settled and we loved it here, that it was a good time to start a family. I have had a large family, 5 sisters, 4 that are living, an aunt that lived with us, of course, my mom, my dad. Holidays for me was 25 to 30, 35 people, almost every Thanksgiving and Christmas. So in my mind, that's what we were going to do. And so we decided in 1995 it was time to start a family, so we got pregnant. We did not want to know the sex of our child, so we decided to make it a surprise. I decided to run a naming campaign with our junior high class, which was called the mid-teens at the time. We'd have 55 to 60, 75 sometimes over there, and they could turn in names. Some of you are in here today who were in that with me. They would turn in names. I wish I had saved those names. I would get names like Caesar Augustus, right, and Hercules and things like that, you know, as you can imagine junior hires would do. And January rolls around 96, and it's time for our birth. And things had been pretty much normal. We headed to the hospital that morning in early January, and, you know, things were kind of going along okay there for a little while. But it became pretty obvious pretty quick that something was different. Luke couldn't, heart rate would not stay stabilized. And to make a long story short, and through a series of pretty traumatic things, they eventually rush in and they take Deidre. And at the time we didn't know, but we know now Luke, rushed him out into emergency surgery, emergency delivery. And both of them had almost died in delivery. We had perhaps seen some things in Deidre's life, and by the way, she's perfectly okay with me sharing all this today. You'll see why here in a little while. That maybe some things that weren't quite right, but we weren't quite sure. But the woman who went into labor delivery that day and that came out was not the same person. For a while, her OBGYN would say, postpartum, postpartum, postpartum. But after about 3 or 4 months, it was obvious that postpartum wasn't what was happening here. At that point, I had to have somebody with her pretty much all the time, pretty much 24 hours a day. So I'm up here at work over in the gym in my office, and my father-in-law calls me. He says, you need to come home. And so I came home and walked in the door to find an extremely broken woman. I wasn't sure what to do. It was obvious that it was something severe, and you know, in those days, and perhaps even still in your lives, but in those days, mid-90s, you just didn't talk about whatever I thought this might be, but I wasn't sure. But I had heard on the KLTY radio station, which I believe is still a radio station, there used to be a clinic called the Minrith Meyer New Life Clinic, and they used to advertise on KLTY all the time. It was a Christian psychiatry clinic. I called and I said, hey, I need to bring my wife over. The lady asked what's going on. I said, I have no idea. Explained to her what is happening. Deidre was kind of nonverbal. And I said, she said, well, you can come. You know, she said, don't come over here. Do you have insurance? I said, no, we don't. And she said, well, don't come here. We don't accept anybody that doesn't have insurance. I said, well, I don't have any other place to go. So I loaded her up, and me and her mother-in-law took her over. When we got there, apparently, Dr. Frank Minrith had been out to the desk because the woman said, well, here is a questionnaire. You need to answer this. I told you not to come, Mr. Johnson. I said, well, so I sat down and filled out the longest questionnaire I ever had. About that time, Dr. Minrith shows up. It was past hours. And he said, Mr. Miss Johnson. I said, yeah. He says, why don't you come back and join me? We went back to join him in his office. And Dr. Minrith began to share with me what he thought was going on here. And so I'll just say this now. My wife suffers from severe mental illness, bipolar. And it has been a journey. She's a warrior. She's a warrior. She did not ask for this. And she's been a warrior through it. If you have that today, you have hope. And you're a warrior too. So hang in there. Male or female, but get help. And so we talked to him well past the time that should have been closed. He was $150 an hour in 96. We went to get up and leave, and he said, oh, Mr. Johnson, your wife has to stay here with me. And it was like everything collapsed upon me at that moment. After some talking with him and convincing of Dr. Minrith, he agreed to let me take Deidre home. I had called Paul and Lynn, Preacher Miss Blue, Miss Annie, who was here in first service. They had gotten two households set up. I remember the drive home. I dropped Deidre off first, where she would be staying. And I remember driving over to where my little boy was. And I remember looking into those little blue eyes and so uncertain of what was going to come next in his life. So uncertain of what was going to come next in my life. If I had known then, thank God, God only shows us that day, right? That's what he says, right? Lived when? Today. Don't worry about tomorrow. He says, look at the birds and the flowers. Do they worry about tomorrow? No. There's enough trouble today. Just focus on today. If I had known then what I know now, I probably would have gotten in that little orange Chevy Corsica, no, not Corsica, Corolla, whatever it was, and driven as far as I could. The same car that 2 weeks prior to this, I'm driving home from the church for lunch, and the driver's side door literally flies off as I'm turning. Goes across the intersection. I'm strapped in the seatbelt, and I'm just driving with no door. I pick it up. I take it to my father-in-law's house, and he's like, where's the door? I said, it's in the back seat. I would have driven away. I remember getting my father-in-law's cordless phone and walking to the back of the garden of his property and calling Preacher. Saying, Preacher, I don't know what's going on. Dr. Minrith had told us that if I could keep them from each other and keep them both safe till he said, they'd have to stay apart. And I don't remember everything Preacher said that night. Preacher Miss Blue, as Paul said a few weeks ago, had lost a daughter, Paul's sister, older sister. But I do remember Preacher said this. He said, Steve, all things. All things. All things work for good. For those who love him and who've been called for his purpose. So that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about how all things can work for good. All things. So, first of all, it has drawn me closer to God. Matthew 11, 28 through 30 says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Come to who? Come to me, Jesus, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Folks, I cannot even tell you. I don't know where you might try to turn, and certainly there have been times that I have turned to other things, but there is no other place to turn in any moment in our life, but certainly in the all things moments, then to Jesus. Now, this church has been amazing. Paul's been my boss and friend for 18 years. Much of my ministry here has been without my wife because she just can't. And if you know, you understand. And I've been able to talk to Paul about everything. But folks, there is nobody to turn to in the all things than there is like Jesus. And you might try to turn to a million other things, and I promise you, as they have me, they will leave you empty and broken and feeling unsatisfied, I promise you, because he is the one we turn to. We see in John chapter 6, Jesus was a rock star. He was a modern day Beatles, Taylor Swift, whatever, right? I mean, man, crowds were following him everywhere he went. He was healing, he was feeding. He had thousands of people following him. The throngs were following him everywhere. But in John chapter 6, there begins to be a little bit of a shift, right? Because it turned from what Jesus was doing for them to what Jesus was sent here for. And all of a sudden, the message got a little more difficult. It wasn't just this prosperity gospel. Jesus was sent here to give us, give us, give us, give us. It was, I came here for a purpose. And it wasn't what they thought. And so the crowds began to leave by the thousands. It says, actually, followers, disciples, people that were claiming him. Jesus turns to Peter, and he asks Peter and the disciples, he says, are you guys leaving me too? Are you guys leaving me too? And Peter looks at Jesus, and he says, Lord, to whom shall we go? Ask yourself that question. In the all things moments, where do you go? The answer needs to be Jesus. It's drawn others close to God. All things have a purpose. And one of the purpose, God did not put us here for ourselves. That might be a surprise to a lot of us, especially in the most selfish, self-centered country on the planet, where everybody has to see how good our life is through social media all the time. But we were not put here to live life alone or just to just suck it all in and eat it all up and have it all for ourselves. God put us here for others. And through that, we bring glory to him. This is what 2 Corinthians 1, 3 through 7 says. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort. Paul says, so praise to God, right? Who comforts us in all of our troubles. So God comforts us if we turn to him, right? So that we can then comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. So as God comforts us, then as we see someone else going through something similar, then we can what? Comfort them. We can walk alongside them. We can come alongside them and put our arm around them and say, hey, I understand what you're going through. No, you don't. Yes, I do. I work one day a week across the street at Glen Oaks, and I tell them every single week, man, I am here sliding my arm around you, telling you that I understand what you're going through, and there is hope in Jesus. If we are distressed, it is for our comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings that we suffer. And our hope for you is firm because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our comfort. I'm not sure when the shift happened in me. But I understood pretty quickly that in the area of mental and emotional health, it's just hard to talk about. We'll go talk to somebody about our diabetes or our cancer or our gout or a bad tooth. But people do not want to talk about this issue. So I decided that as I was learning and as we started seeing psychiatrists and therapists and hospital stays and trying to figure it out and trying to take the stuff that Dr. Minrith, through the all things moment of that he had poured into me and the other therapists and counselors we see, and folks, I know my lane. I know I send people to get help. But I would say, hey, come talk to me. Come talk to me. And I began to create an avenue for people who didn't know where to go or how to get started to find some help. And now thousands of people that have come through this church's doors and many in these last two services have started their journey to healing in Jesus, not in me. In that office right back there. Because if we're going to have to go through it, we're not going to have to go through it alone. We're going to share with others. We're going to talk to others. And I'm going to try to help others. I say often, pain hurts. The Bible says in this life there will be troubles. And pain just stinks. It defeats us all time, physical, emotional, spiritual. It'll devour us. And if we're not careful, it can destroy friendships, relationships, and faith. So what do? We give it purpose, meaning, and value in the lives of others. All things work for good to those who love Him and are called for a purpose to glorify God. And one of the best ways we glorify God in our valleys, in our pains, in our struggles, is by availing ourselves and helping others. I've learned that God is with me wherever I go. Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Now let me give you a little background here in this verse. So this is Joshua here, Moses, the great leader, the great patriarch, a man of faith, as it said in Hebrews. Moses had led the children of Israel out of captivity and slavery in Egypt and had led them to the precipice of claiming the Holy Land, but because of their sin and because they were complainers and a bunch of other things, you can read it, great, great read, true read. Moses never got to lead them in, and so they had to turn and go back. Moses himself sinned, and they wandered in the desert for 40 years until all that generation died off and a new generation had been raised up. And now they're back at the Jordan River during the month of Nisan. It's flooded. It could be as much as a mile wide. And now it's Joshua. God has anointed Joshua, one of the only two to give a positive report when Moses sent the spies across 40 years earlier to lead them across. And I think Joshua was scared to death. And I think he thought, I am not Moses. Who am I, God, to take up this task? I think he was scared. I think he was discouraged. I think there was a lot of things going on in him, and he did not believe he was the man for the job. And this is what God said to him. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? strong and courageous in what? Well, not strong and courageous in your brains. Or Joshua, no doubt, even though he's an older guy now, he was trained in warfare. He knew how to lead people. I mean, no, don't be strong and courageous in your bank account or in your degrees or anything. Nothing wrong with any of those, but that's not where we draw our strength and our courage. He says also, Joshua, don't be afraid and don't be discouraged. Why? Because the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Because the Lord our God is with us wherever we go. It's the fall 2017. We had a bad car wreck. I was should have been killed in it, according to the highway patrol. Deidre was driving. In the proceeding from 96 to 2017, her bipolar does what bipolar does. And since she has a severe case, there were times of things weren't good, and there were times that things were good. We were on a trip, and we're outside Huntsville, and that happened. And that had a real effect on her. Some trauma, some added PTSD. And going into 2018, what I didn't know is that my wife had spent several months preparing to take her life. We had an appointment to see her psychiatrist that day, I think somewhere around noon. I was going to go home and pick her up about 11:30, 11:45, but I got a phone call from a dear friend of mine. In short, he said, I think you need to go home. I went home about 30 or 45 minutes earlier than I should have. Had I not gotten that phone call, she would have passed away. Her heartbeat was 3 beats a minute. All things. That morning, I had been messaging with a young couple who was in my small group. He's a first responder, paramedic, EMT, fireman here in Greenville. We've been messaging back and forth about group and a few other things, just having a good time. I get the phone call. I drive home. I walk into the house. I immediately know that something's not right. If you've ever been in one of those situations, you immediately call 911. Thank you for all of our first responders. Thank you. She stays on the line with me until the fire department and the ambulance shows up. She says, Mr. Johnson, they are at your front door. You can go to the front door. Please let them in. So I hang up. I go to the front door. And the person who greeted me at the door is the young man I'd been speaking to all morning. If you don't believe in God, his eyes get that wide. He's kind of in shock because he never thinks he was going to pull up to his pastor's house. And then he looks at me and he says, Steve, you go to the living room. We've got this. I called Paul with my next phone call. He probably drove, as I told first hour, 100 miles an hour to get there. In the next few days, few weeks, Deidre was in a coma and things were crazy. But through that entire time, I never doubted that God was there with me. And if you've ever been in a situation like that and you've turned to anybody else but God, then you might not understand. But if you've ever understood the peace that passes all understanding, or you've had it, it was probably at a time like that, and you understand exactly what I'm talking about. I've learned that God does not have a supply problem. Philippians 4:19 says, and my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. Now, I am primarily talking about financial here, but it also applies. God doesn't have a grace need or a financial problem, or he wants to meet your emotional needs. He wants to meet your relational needs, right? God loves you. He views you as one of his beautiful, wonderful creations, and he loves you dearly. And when we turn to him, we understand that he does not have a supply problem. Sometimes we have a demand problem, but he does not have a supply problem. As I mentioned, this church has been incredibly blessed us and been gracious to us, but we have faced this disease of mental illness without insurance for over 28 years now. I remember going all the way back, Dr. Minwith told me, he said, Steve, this is the most expensive disease in the world to treat that's not called cancer. I did not say this in first hour, but if we were going to pay for the medicines out of pocket right now that they want her to have, they'd be about $7,000 a month. True story. Folks, when we leave here, God willing, well, we are leaving here in May. But if things hold true, we will leave here debt-free. That's the biggest amen right there, and you should clap, because that's a testimony to God. We have never had a wealthy benefactor that has paid all our bills. Have we had people bless us? My gosh, we have. We have had a few people in our lives that have loved us deep and hard, and they know who they are. But I'll tell you another way he meets our needs in that area. He does not have a supply problem. So fast forward over 20 years. Fast forward actually about 23 years, 24 years, I guess. Maybe, I don't know, my math's not working well right now. And I'm on my way to speak at the Attic. It's a Wednesday night. It's about 4:30 on a Wednesday. I believe it was early 2017. And this was our off-campus teen church at the time. And we had crossed the bridge there at Walmart, and being a man, you never turn around, right? You always are going forward in a vehicle, so you got to make good time, even in town. And so we had 100 restaurants we could eat in between crossing the bridge and the Attic, but she wanted to go to Cracker Barrel. So being a good husband, we turned around and went to Cracker Barrel. It's about 4:30 when we get there. We sit down, and I say, Deidre, about 10 minutes in, I say, Deidre, that's Dr. Minwith. She said, babe, no, it's not. I said, no, that's Dr. Minwith. We hurry through our meal. I walk over to his table. I carried with, at the time, a black wallet, and I had a picture of her and Luke when Luke was about 3 months old, about the time that all this started. And I took that picture out. I was already crying. And I just handed it to his wife. And I said, thank you for sharing your husband with us. He saved their life. And through his ministry and me, I've helped save others. His wife looked up at us with tears in her eyes. And I forgot to tell this in first service. They had actually driven all the way through Greenville and out the other side. And he said, I think I want Cracker Barrel. Now, what man says that, right? But anyway, well, you already passed it. They turned around and they came back to Cracker Barrel. That's a God thing. She looks at me with tears in her eyes and she says, this has been the hardest day in our life. After the hardest weeks we've ever faced. She says, we're on our way to Arkansas to our ranch to try to regroup. We're not sure what's going on in our lives and our ministry right now, but we needed to hear from you today. Thank you for sharing. Dr. Minwith asked me if I would walk with him out to his car. I did. Folks, I could share 500 stories like that, how God's met our needs or used us to meet the needs of others. He said, Mr. Johnson, you know how much we needed this today. I said, Dr. Minwith, you've meant so much to us and others. Folks, God doesn't have a supply problem. All things. All things. All things work for good. Finally, I've learned that relationships can thrive in the all things. If you were to Google right now, divorce in bipolar marriages, it's going to say, Google's going to tell you 2 to 3 times the national average. That means that you would have a 100% chance of getting divorced or a 150% chance of getting divorced. As it is, it does stand around 90, 93%. I'm not going to say we haven't been through our difficult times. I'm not going to say we have not struggled. I'm not going to say that things have always been great. Of the 10,700 nights that we have been married, give or take a 75 or so, our anniversary's in June, for most of you, 8,000 of those nights have been pretty dysfunctional by your standards. Because bipolar's ugly and it's messy. But Genesis 2:24 says that is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. And folks, I'm going to tell you that in the all things with God and the center of things and the purpose, whether it be cancer or bipolar or finances or what her and I are facing right now, uncertain what we are going into or how we're even going to support ourselves, in all things, God works for good. All things. Let's bow our heads. Started today with the most important of the all things. And that is, you know who Jesus is as your Lord and Savior. Look, the other things won't begin to fall into line for you, and you perhaps won't begin to understand the purpose that God... Matter of fact, you might even be extremely angry and bitter. I have been at times, I'll promise you, I've been angry and bitter and said, God, why? But if you choose to turn towards Jesus and understand that all things can work for His good when we just don't always focus on ourselves, but we begin to focus outward into others, and we see how it teaches us to rely upon Him, and we see how God repeatedly steps to the plate and meets our needs, and we see that even in those darkest moments, man, we had some dark moments this past fall, some dark moments where it was just me and her and the Lord. And you realize He's there with you no matter what. But listen to me, if you don't know Jesus as your Savior, you're not ready for that yet. And you can accept Him as your Savior sitting right there, right now. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, die and go to hell. We're all going to die physically, but have everlasting life in heaven. And He goes on to say, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father, Jesus says, except through me. It's not about how good you are or how much money you've given. It is through a relationship with Jesus Christ, who God sent to this earth to die on the cross for our sins, because He loves us immaculately. And all you have to do, and I'm not trying to make that sound trite or like it's no big deal. I understand. It can be extremely difficult to turn from our wicked ways and to turn to Him and say, Jesus, I love You. Come into my heart and save me and forgive me my sins. I give my life to You. But I tell you what, if you will decide to do that today, if you have never done it in a minute, He will save you and He will give meaning and purpose to the all things in your life too. Let's pray. Father, we love You. We thank You so much for Your blessings. Thank You so much for bringing us here today, God. I'm thankful. I'm not saying the all things have been easy. I'm not saying they haven't been difficult. I'm not saying, God, that Deidre and I wouldn't change things if we could, but this has been Your path for us. And if this is Your path, then we have to figure out how to glorify You through it. Pray that we would continue to do that and that this church would as well. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Man, what a great reminder that God can work through all things, right? And even as God leads Steve and Deidre down a different road, keep them in your prayers, because God's not done with them yet. He's not done with us as a church, but keep them in your prayers as they seek God's will for their lives. If you prayed this morning to accept Christ as your personal Savior, please let us know by filling out a Connect card. You can do that with the card in front of you or through the app. If you're new to Family Fellowship, please let us know also by filling out a Connect card, and we'd love to meet you. I'll be at the information booth outside these doors in the plaza. Come find me. I have a gift for you. I'd love to meet you and find out how you found us here at Family Fellowship this morning. Maybe you just need somebody to talk to or pray with you. The Prayer Connection team meets in a room outside these doors to your right. And would love to encourage you with whatever you might have going on in your life. Easter is 2 weeks from today, so it's going to be a crazy day. We're looking forward to that. There's going to be three service times at 8, 9:30, and 11 a.m. We will have Kid Street open for all age groups in Kid Street at the 9:30 and 11 o'clock service. But at the 8 o'clock service, there will only be nursery age groups open. So that's like 18 months and down. Otherwise, you're more than welcome to bring the other kiddos into the main service here and just participate as a family. We're going to have the Easter egg drop after the 9:30 and 11 o'clock service time. We're going to have a helicopter fly in and drop some eggs, and you won't be underneath it. You won't get hit in the face with an egg. Don't worry. You'll be out of the way, so no worries there. Also, on your way out, we have Easter signs still available for you to grab and put in your yard or your neighbor's yard if you want to prank them, whatever. Go for it. Also, communion is the Friday before Easter. We'll have that starting at 6 p.m. the Friday before Easter. And lastly, if you haven't already signed up to be a part of getting your picture taken for the directory, be sure to do that. You can do that through the app, or you can see the ladies out here at this table in the plaza this morning. That's it. Have a great week. Y'all are dismissed.